be with you.
And also with you.
I always know when the Jaguars have an early game. I'm glad you're here today. It's great to see you. You know, this is the second to the last Sunday of the church year. In other words, in 2 weeks, we'll be celebrating the first Sunday in Advent. We'll be lighting the Advent wreath for the first time. That's how quickly time flies. And you can also say that you have read through, well, at least next week, at the conclusion, you will have read through the entire book of Mark. If you've been coming here regularly during this church year, we've actually read through, and I've preached exclusively on the Gospel of Mark, and next week I'll bring that to conclusion. I think Pastor Nate and Vicar Jonathan have preached pretty much through the book of Hebrews. For the most
part.
More or less. So that's a really wonderful thing. In fact, speaking of the vicar, he is not here today. He's at St. Paul Lutheran Church preaching there. Their interim pastors, you know, last February their pastor died, and they really had some struggles. I preached there, Pastor Nate has preached there, and they have an interim pastor. And now he's had a death in his family. So the president of the church called and said, Pastor Dan, is there anything you can do? Can you help? So I voluntold Vicar that he was going to do it. And so he's doing that today. And it's a wonderful thing that he's doing. And he's doing good things, but he's totally fine just helping out another congregation. We have so many blessings here at Bethlehem. God has just poured out his generous presence, his gifts, and the people of God. Many of you, in fact, 24 of you helped yesterday clean up the church grounds, clean up in here. Shirley, it's sparkling. Thank you. She did a lot of the work with Alan here in the sanctuary, and others worked outside, Pastor Nate, youth in the playground. So thank you to all who came and 8 o'clock yesterday morning until noon and worked here. Really appreciate it. And then to the food fight, there were 16 participants that helped with, they call it the food fight, preparing emergency packets for those who have emergency food needs. So thank you, Holly, for organizing that, and for all of you who helped serve in that way. Really appreciate it. So in regarding our thankfulness and all the things that we're so thankful for, a week from this Wednesday, it'll be the Wednesday the 24th, we have our Thanksgiving Eve service. Last year, for many reasons, I was out on disability still. COVID was really ramping up. Didn't have a whole lot of participation in the Thanksgiving Eve service, but I hope that that'll be different this year as we return thanks to our Lord in our special Thanksgiving Eve service on Wednesday the 24th at 7 p.m. Also, finally, from my part, we're going to be recognizing our veterans. We always celebrate on the Sunday closest to Veterans Day. This year it was Thursday, so we're going to recognize our veterans today, and that'll take place just before the prayers of the church and Holy Communion. Pastor?
Thank you, Pastor. So the first day announcement I have is on behalf of Vicar, really, but I'm the one making it. Which means it will be briefer than if Vicar were making it. If he watches the live stream later, he'll have a little surprise for him. We love him. But I love to pick on him. This Friday, if you're a young adult, this Friday we're all meeting in his backyard and just having a young adult social time. Bring kids. Children are welcome and, in fact, encouraged. And just a time of relaxing, hot dogs, hamburgers, s'mores, and just enjoying the backyard and the cool autumn temperatures. It's a good time of year for that. So if you know a young adult in the congregation, be sure to remind them of that this Friday. 5:30 or so is when is the earliest. Any time after that, you're fine to drop by too. But beginning 5:30, that's when the McCarty clan will descend upon his premises. So that's this weekend. Also, the day before that, Thursday, right, Pastor Bickness? Thursday at 6 o'clock is the men's Bible study. Potato soup is on the menu this Thursday night at 6, and then Bible study at 7. If you're a man needing some good soup and some good word of the Lord, Pastor Bickness does a great job with that. So.
Excellent. Very good. Well, we're here to worship, so let's stand. We'll face the processional cross for our opening hymn, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. There is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. The one who endures to the end will be saved. We take a moment of silence for personal reflection and to see our need for forgiveness. Let us confess our sins to God our Father. I confess to God Almighty, before the whole company of heaven, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own fault, by my own most grievous fault. Wherefore I pray God Almighty to have mercy on me, forgive me all my sins, and bring me to everlasting life. The Almighty and merciful Lord grant you pardon, forgiveness, and remission of all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Having heard those powerful words of forgiveness, let's stand and sing the doxology, "Praise God from whom all blessings flow." But you have saved us by blood, the blood of your Son shed upon the cross. Grant that no sin remain in us and that we walk in holiness all the days of our life and with confidence in your promise until at last our Lord comes to deliver us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Congregation may be seated. Our first reading for this second to the last Sunday of the church year is recorded in the book of Daniel, the 12th chapter, where Daniel writes that those who are wise shall shine like the stars. At that time shall arise Michael, the great prince who has charge of your people. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never has been since there was a nation till that time. But at that time your people shall be delivered, everyone whose name shall be found written in the book. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the sky above, and those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading is recorded in the book of Hebrews, the 10th chapter, where the author writes about a single sacrifice for sin, a single sacrifice once and for all for our sins. And every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also bears witness to us. For after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days," declares the Lord, "I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds." Then he adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more." Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain that is through his flesh, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 13th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. And as he came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what wonderful stones and what wonderful buildings." And Jesus said to him, "Do you see these great buildings? There will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down." And as he sat on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter and James and John and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will these things be? And what will be the sign when all these things are about to be accomplished?" And Jesus began to say to them, "See that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name, saying, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. And when you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. These are but the beginnings of the birth pains. But be on your guard, for they will deliver you over to councils, and you will be beaten in synagogues, and you will stand before governors and kings for my sake, to bear witness before them. And the gospel must first be proclaimed to all nations. And when they bring you to trial and deliver you over, do not be anxious beforehand what you are to say, but say whatever is given you in that hour, for it is not you who speak, but the Holy Spirit. And brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake, but the one who endures to the end will be saved." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us now join together and confess our holy Christian faith to one another and with Christians throughout the world in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
As we anticipate that day when we stand before you face to face, as we wait, we ask that you would be with us, that you would be with the words of my mouth, that you would be with the meditations of all of our hearts and our minds as we meditate on your word today. Be with us, O Lord, for the sake of your church, we pray. Amen. The text for today's message comes to us from the epistle reading in Hebrews chapter 10, and this is one of those where I would strongly encourage you to have the text in front of you in some way, maybe on your phone or your pew Bible, or if you brought your Bible with you, but just to have that text, Hebrews chapter 10, in front of you. It's a little bit dense. In fact, it's a lot. It's a challenging text. And we're going to look at verses, especially we're going to look at verses 16 through 25. So a good bit of Bible today. And I think if we just have it in front of us, it will help us navigate a little bit better, perhaps. So we're in Hebrews 10. We'll start at verse 16 eventually. But I thought while you're getting there, I might just start this morning by asking you what you're doing here. Not that I'm not glad you're here. I'm quite pleased with that. But what are you doing here? Don't you have something better you could be doing this morning? Or put another way, what's the point? Why are we doing this thing we're doing? Today's epistle reading sheds some light on the purpose of our gathering together as the church. Shocker, I know, there's actually a reason that God calls us together into a physical, time-bound, space-bound gathering. And the reason is simple. By gathering us together as His church, God is getting us ready for Judgment Day. By gathering us together as His church, God is getting us ready for Judgment Day. You may have noticed that theme in our readings today. We're not at the end of the church year yet, but we're getting awfully close, and you can already hear it in the readings. Our Old Testament reading from Daniel spoke of that last day, and if you were to go on reading in that section, he uses some very apocalyptic language about the time of the end. And in our gospel reading, Jesus begins by foretelling the destruction of the temple, but then he kind of morphs into the general destruction of the world and the chaos that goes on as the ages end. So the theme is definitely here already today, the end. And for us as Christians, of course, a recognition of the end is always in view. A Christian recognizes that the end is coming. The end or your end, either way. There is a day, right? There's a day of judgment, reckoning, whatever you want to call it. It will be that capital D day at the end of all your little lowercase d days. And our epistle reading keys in on this theme as well, ending with the words in verse 25, as you see the day drawing near. So, that's the theme. We see the day drawing near. We are sort of now listening in as the author to Hebrews writes to the Christians under his care, reminding them that God is at work to prepare them for that day. And I'd like to tease out three things, hopefully three somewhat coherent things, that God does to us through and that God does to us in His church to prepare us for that day. First and most fundamentally, in church, God makes us and keeps us Christians. In church, God makes us and keeps us Christians. In verses 16 and 17, the preacher to the Hebrews, he's quoting from the prophet Jeremiah. If you're looking at that in your Bible, you might see it kind of indented in a special way. He's quoting the prophet Jeremiah, and these words from Jeremiah are really words from the mouth of the Lord. They're words that describe what will happen under the new covenant that was coming in the person and work of Jesus. And what will happen, the Lord says, is He will put His laws on their hearts and write them on their minds. And what's more, He will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. The author then comments, where there is forgiveness of these sins, there are no longer sacrifices for sins going on. So this new covenant is going to involve God shaping His people quite directly, placing His laws, His ways on their very hearts and minds. This new covenant is also going to involve forgiveness of sins, and God choosing, for all practical purposes, to banish our sins from His memory, which is a pretty wonderful picture of forgiveness. But what we might be tempted to miss is that this forgiveness happens someplace. That's why the author uses the word where, because he actually means where, as in the places where there is this forgiveness, we don't need those old covenant sacrifices anymore. Where, he says. Does God bring His forgiveness to bear particularly in any particular places? Sounds like it. How about in any particular ways? Well, because of this forgiveness, starting in verse 19, we can have the confidence to approach God by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that He opened for us, that is, through His flesh. That is the way we come to God and the way He comes to us with forgiveness, making us Christians, those forgiven by Christ. We approach God as forgiven people by the blood of Jesus and through His flesh. Does this sound like a Sunday morning yet? The sacraments are all over the book of Hebrews. We have to keep in mind kind of that this letter, like most of the New Testament letters, were written to be read out loud in the context of a church gathering. The letter would be the sermon that day, and the songs and the Holy Supper and all that surrounded the reading of the word, just like today. And it's in that context we can read verse 22. Let us draw near to God in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. We'll talk about these actions separately, but first let's just talk about them together. Sprinkled, washed. You hear it in the words themselves that these are both passive ideas. It's not something you do, it's something that's done to you. And the author to the Hebrews says that these are things that God has done to these people, so that they can approach God that day in and on that capital D day, so that they can approach him prepared. So, what does it mean to have our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience? At first, we might hear the word sprinkled and think, aha, baptism. But that may not be it. Elsewhere in this letter, whenever sprinkling is mentioned, it quite specifically refers to the sprinkling of Jesus' blood. Sprinkling blood. Well, that connects us. Sprinkling blood connects us back to the priests in the Old Testament. You remember how they would be sprinkled with the blood of the sacrifice to make them holy and forgiven and pure. Does God ever cleanse us with the blood of a sacrifice? With the blood of the greater sacrifice? Does he ever sprinkle us with the blood of the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world? My sin, your sin. Does he ever give us a pure conscience so that we know and we hear his word that none of our sins define us any longer, but that we are pure in sight of him? Does that ever happen? Well, take, drink. This is the blood of the new covenant shed for you. With this blood, you are well prepared for that day. God has made you so in his church. In fact, you are doubly prepared for that day, because not only do you have a clean conscience through the blood he applies to you in his supper, but you have also had, the text tells us, you've had the filth of your sin washed away with pure water. Any detectives in the assembly today? You want to guess what this one refers to? Maybe baptism. So here we have it. God's word written on our hearts, his sacraments, water in the body and blood of his son, granting forgiveness, all of it being given to us in his church and preparing us for that day. In his church, God creates and maintains Christians. But God doesn't stop there. These other two things that God does are perhaps lesser in consequence, which is good, because I'm running out of sermon time. But they're not less true. The second thing is that in his church, God uses us to spur each other on to love and good works. In his church, God uses us to spur each other on. That's verse 24. Let us consider how to stir up one another in love and good works. The thing about good works is that you can't do them to yourself. That's called selfishness. Or at the very least, self-care, or some sort of euphemism for selfishness. To do a good work, you have to have somebody else to do it to. You need people to do them to. And in the church, God has surrounded you with people who need your loving deeds. You know, when that capital D day comes, we often say, you can't take it with you. Which I guess we say to to rightly indicate the finality of that day, I suppose. But you know what God's word says? Revelation 14:13. I heard a voice from heaven telling me to write, "Blessed are the dead, those who die in the Lord from this moment on." Yes, says the Spirit, they will rest from their labors, for their deeds will follow them. One way to understand this is that your good works truly do have an impact and leave a legacy and have sort of a reverberating set of consequences. And on that day, they will actually matter. They won't matter for salvation, but your kindness toward your brothers and sisters here, your involvement in church activities and service, and we've had so much of that already this fall, these good deeds actually do matter. And God provides those opportunities for our good, to prepare us for that day. Third, and finally, in church, God uses us to encourage one another with the hope that we have. In church, God uses us to encourage each other. And this is really what it all comes down to in our final verse. We do not want to neglect to meet together, as is the habit of some, but we want to be encouraging one another, and all the more as we see the day approaching. Encouragement. Hope. Again, you can't really encourage people without interacting with people. That's why God calls us to be together, to remind each other of the hope we have, even when things look hopeless, to encourage each other that whatever else may be going on in work or in politics or in our family, here there is hope. Here there is encouragement. You know, even if all you do is make it to church on Sunday morning and sit in the pew, and that's all you can bring yourself to do, because it's been a week, and you don't even feel like talking to anyone. But if all you do is sit in the pew or in the chair in Bible class, and you're just sitting there, even your very presence itself is an encouraging witness to every single person around you that there is more to life than the troubles of the past week. Just your very presence is a witness to the fact that we have hope, because that day is coming. And for us, that day is not a day to be feared. It's a day to be welcomed, because we have been well prepared simply by being where God has gathered us, simply by being who we are, His church. You know, I guess I started by asking what you were doing here. And maybe in a sense the answer is not much. But God's doing a whole lot when you're here. He makes us Christians. He keeps us in the faith with His body and blood. And He uses us to bring about good works and encouragement. God's pretty busy. Because of what God does in church, we get to meet Him full of confidence and joy, with a clear conscience, with full assurance. We needn't doubt for a minute whether we've received His forgiveness or not, because, well, He gives it out right here in this place where there is forgiveness of sin. I don't know about you, but I like this place. Amen.
the things that I like about this place is that every year we recognize our veterans. It's important to me personally because I came out of a military family and so did my wife, but it's not only for them, it's for all of those that we know and don't know, those who have been a part of this Bethlehem congregation that have served God and country so selflessly and sacrificially. Another reason that I like to recognize our veterans at this congregation is I remembered yesterday when we were working outside doing the cleanup. Some of you may not know that we have three benches outside dedicated to three members of this congregation who are now with the Lord who were prisoners of war. And one of the prisoners of war was Bob Wilkins. He is now sainted, called to his heavenly home several years ago, but I recall the story that he told me. He was captured, placed in a prisoner of war camp in Korea. And there was a chaplain, he happened to be a Lutheran chaplain, that had such an impact on Bob Wilkins, he became a Christian. And he became a Lutheran Christian because the chaplain was a Lutheran chaplain. And this chaplain would sing hymns. And he would get the members of the prisoner of war camp to sing the hymns with him. And it so infuriated his captors that they would throw him into a dungeon for 30 days, limited food and water, no sunshine, and then they would let him out. And he's so weak and starving, but after a few days, he would start singing hymns again. And he would get the whole prisoner of war camp to sing the hymns with him. And they would throw him back in the dungeon, they'd let him out, and he would start singing again. Eventually, he died. The chaplain died. And it had such an impact on Bob that he said, this man's sacrifice and his faith in his Lord so strong, his faith in the Savior who gave up everything, we heard about the sacrifice today, that impacted Bob's life and became a very active part of the church until he passed away several years ago. But those are some of the things that our men and women in uniform have endured that are far beyond any of our imaginings, even our worst imaginings, and I think that's one of the reasons that we recognize them and give thanks to them. And so I'm going to name the conflict or the war, and if you served during that time, I would like you to please stand up, and I'd like the congregation to recognize them with our applause. Do we have anyone in this service today that served during World War II? Do we have anyone? I think this is now the third year in a row that we haven't had anyone who served in World War II. There are very few of these individuals left, but we certainly remember them on Veterans Day and thank God for their sacrifice. How about Korea? Anyone here served during Korea? Thank you, sir, for your service. God bless you. About Vietnam? Anyone served during Vietnam? We have Joseph, Robert, Mark. Thank you all very much. Could you please remain standing? And sir, would you be able to stand for just a couple? I know you're, like most military guys, they're very humble, and you're not asking for any recognition. We want to give it to you today. How about Iraq and the Gulf War? Anyone served during that time? David? Thank you. Susan? Afghanistan and Syria, anyone served during that time? How about during peacetime? Yep, John, thank you very much, and Pastor Keith. And anyone who is currently serving, if you would please stand, if we have anybody that's currently serving. Thank you all so much. We thank God for you. If everybody could now stand, could you please stand and show your appreciation with your applause? And please remain standing. We're going to join together as we honor all who served as we sing God Bless Our Native Land. Of Veterans Day, we pray that you would bless our service members, their families, our nation, and its leaders. Grant our political and military leaders wisdom, strength, courage, and kindness to govern our nation in a manner that brings glory to you and serves the people of our country. Let our nation's leaders be guided by the power of hope that is only in Jesus, that they may govern in humility and compassion, with justice and mercy for all. Move all of us to work together in forging a compassionate and peaceful nation. We pray for all those who mourn the death of the fallen heroes who made the ultimate sacrifice for our nation and the freedoms we embrace. And we thank you, Lord, for all men and women in uniform who have served and continue to serve God and country with sacrifice and selflessness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Preserve your church throughout the world and keep us ready at all times for your Son's glorious return. Lead us to proclaim with zeal his coming to the ends of the earth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give you thanks, Holy Lord, for the fruits of the earth provided by your hand. Supply the needs of all who grow, process, and distribute our food, and move us to share these bountiful gifts with our neighbors in their time of need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Provide compassionate care and keeping for the sick and infirm, the dying, and all in need, especially Ben Bryant, who goes back to the hospital this week, Sue Eichen, and Gene Wells, who is recovering from surgery this past Friday. We pray that you would grant them healing of body and patience to endure their afflictions. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And thank you, Lord, for the gift of a healthy baby girl, Gianna, born to Brandon and Tricia Burgaines. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give repentance and faith to all who approach the altar at Christ's gracious invitation, that they may find favor in your eyes and receive his true body and blood for the salvation of their souls. Lord, in your mercy, grant these and all our petitions, O God, for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever, and who has taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever.
Give thanks to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing.
Amen.
this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in both body and soul, now and unto life everlasting. Live in that peace and depart in that peace. Amen. Let us return thanks. Almighty God, before us lie many days of blood and fear. Grant to us the gift of your Spirit, that we not forget, but always rejoice in the redemption born of Christ's blood on the cross. Be daily forgiven by his blood shed once for all, and be refreshed through our communion in his flesh and blood. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Receive the benediction of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. Peace, to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.